dark matter, called dark matter because we can't easily use electromagnetic radiation to detect them, as we normally do with other objects. Doesn't really sound like the end of the world to me. I mean, neutrons, protons, and electrons are things we can't see, but we know they exist. Because they're so small, unlike everyday objects, they don't get excited by visible light that is directed to our eyes, the process that allows us to see things with light. See, apart from detecting things using the forces of gravity and electromagnetism, there are the strong and weak fundamental forces. One way we know neutrons exist is because we see them interact strongly via the weak force, which is the interaction responsible for the decay of elements. Neutrons play a huge role in nuclear fission. You might be thinking, what if the effect of dark matter just came from black holes? Because like dark matter, black holes are things we can't see. Maybe, but the fact that dark matter is pretty spread out makes that less likely to be the explanation. Because black holes are supposed to be gravitationally strong enough to have surrounding matter revolve around them. Scientists have actually observed that the rate of dark matter particle and antiparticle annihilation present to produce the amount of dark matter we see coincides with the rate of this annihilation if dark matter interacted via the weak force. Basically, this is a number, this is another number, and the number we observe in nature is the same if we added them together. This specific theory calls for dark matter to be composed of weakly interacting massive particles, WIMPs. Question is, how do you make an experiment to prove this? See, the standard model of physics is like a classroom. Some groups of friends interact because of their love for dogs, some for Pokemon, so on. These interactions have been quantified for the smallest particles we know of. And just like people, some of these overlap. You could be a proton with a positive charge and interact because of the electromagnetic force, but you could still also interact with a neutron because of the strong force. This is essentially what happens inside particle accelerators. We isolate groups of particles and confirm the math we know of how often they interact in specific ways. Any deviation from the math we know could describe something to further investigate. A new particle, a new force, things like that. So if this theory that dark matter interacts via the weak force, a method to observe WIMPs is to get another particle that we know interacts via the weak force, and observe for any weirdness. So far, we've got none. But if you can't get the WIMPs, go for the SIMPs. That's right, strongly interacting massive particles. See, a problem that comes from dark matter in the form of WIMPs is that it can't really explain why dark matter is uniformly spread out instead of forming high-density centers. On the other hand, if there were strongly interacting massive particles, they would be hitting each other all the time. That we would observe a uniform distribution of dark matter throughout galaxies. And this is what we usually observe. So SIMPs are theorized to be made of a quark and an antiquark glued together. Quarks are the things that make up heavy particles, like protons and neutrons. We know this kind of weird structure is possible in nature because we've observed them, and they're called pions, but that's for another day. So the thing here is this SIMP could have a similar structure that when they interact with each other, the antimatter of another having come into contact with the matter of this other SIMP, they would annihilate each other. The main event that happens when matter comes into contact with its antimatter. Laboratories like the Super KEKB in Japan accelerate electrons and their counterpart antimatter to see if once again there would be any weirdness. And worry not if SIMPs don't turn out to be the answer. Another theory talks about a particle that has no electric charge, no quantum spin, and that interacts with all the fundamental forces except electromagnetic. It should be the reason we can't see them. Dark matter that would have these properties should be detected in a strong magnetic field. Why? There's a specific process where a chargeless, spinless particle would interact with a photon to produce an outgoing photon, and that's called the Primakoff effect. Where can we get a lot of photons? In a magnetic field. But really, there's no way to tell whether dark matter is in fact matter. Neil deGrasse Tyson even said it could be better named as dark gravity, because this is the part that we're absolutely sure of, the gravitational effects of dark matter on space-time. Two of the fundamental forces we know have limitations regarding the distances to which their effects are still noticeable. It could be that at larger scales, our theories in gravity could do a little more updating. So it's not true when people say scientists don't know anything about what dark matter is. We may not exactly know it yet, but that doesn't mean the progress we've done so far means nothing. And the reason why it's good to have facilities all over the world working towards this goal is because the more we know about our world, the more we can ethically use it to our advantage. Years ago, the electron was just another weird particle we didn't understand, but now its ability to move around is the reason you're watching this video. Imagine what we could do with dark matter. A super exciting possibility is a 100% efficient source of energy. Watch this next video and you'll see why. Once again, thanks for watching, I'll see you next time.